ಸರ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಮ್ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ಚೆಕ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಸರ್. ನನಗೆ ನೆಟ್ವರ್ಕ್ ಬರ್ತಾ ಇಲ್ಲ. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಂತ ತೋರಿಸ್ತಿದೆ ಸರ್. ಹಾಂ, ಬಂತು ಸರ್. ಇದೆ ಗುಡ್ ಆಫ್ಟರ್ನೂನ್. Today's theory class is on infectious diseases. We'll start with malaria. Malaria is caused by intracellular parasite called the Plasmodium. It is a worldwide infection which affects 500 million and kills more than 1 million people each year. Plasmodium falciparum causes severe malaria, and there are three other malarial parasites which infect humans, that is the Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium ovale and malaria. All these are transmitted by female Anopheles mosquito. So the life cycle and morphology of malaria. There are two stages in the life cycle of the malarial parasite, that is the asexual phase, which occurs in humans, and the sexual phase, which occurs in mosquitoes. In the asexual phase, the parasites multiply by division, a process called the schizogony. As the cycle takes place in human, it is also called as vertebrate, intrinsic or endogenous phase. In the humans, it occurs in two locations. It can occur within the RBCs, that is called as erythrocytic schizogony, or it can occur in the liver, called as exoerythrocytic. The products of the schizogony are called as merozoites. The sexual phase occurs in female Anopheles mosquito. These sexual forms are called as the gametocytes. The gametocytes mature and fertilization takes place in mosquito, giving rise to sporozoites. Hence this phase is called as sporogony, and it is called as invertebrate, extrinsic or exogenous phase. So the man is an intermediate host for malaria, whereas mosquito is the definite host. This is a flowchart representation of life cycle of the malarial parasite. In the mosquito, that is a female Anopheles mosquito, the gut of the mosquito, the gametocytes fertilize, they develop into oocyst, and this oocyst ruptures, releasing the sporozoites into the salivary glands of the mosquito. When this mosquito bites a human being, the sporozoites are released into the bloodstream, and they can enter the RBCs where they divide, or they can enter the liver where it divides and forms merozoites. These merozoites rupture the RBCs and then again enter into the bloodstream to infect other RBCs. Here they can form gametocytes, which then again enter into the mosquitoes. pathophysiology of the malaria. Hemolysis of parasitized RBCs causes anemia, splenomegaly, thrombocytopenia, leukopenia and jaundice. Tissue ischemia and anoxia causes a variety of problems including cerebral capillary occlusion producing brain dysfunction, centrilobular liver cell necrosis causing hypoglycemia, renal ischemia and cortical hemorrhage causes renal failure. It can also cause placental dysfunction which leads to low birth weight or stillbirth. Other manifestations of malaria are black water fever. It is an acute immune intravascular hemolysis leading to hemoglobinuria and hemoglobinemia, acute renal failure and acute severe anemia. Algid malaria, it represents subnormal temperature, vomiting and oliguria. Due to adrenal crisis, absorption of endotoxin from the gut or tumor necrosis factor from the endotoxin causes activation of macrophages. Tropical splenomegaly syndrome, it is caused due to chronic malaria. So these are the morphological forms. This is Plasmodium vivax, this is Plasmodium malariae, ovale and falciparum. So the early trophozoites are seen in the form of a ring. These are called as ring forms. These are the gametocytes. And this is the schizoid stage and this is the late trophozoid stage. So these are the ring forms within the RBCs. This is a gametocyte within the RBCs. Again ring forms within RBC. This is a stage of schizoid within the RBC. Clinically, malaria presents with fever, chills and rigors, anemia, jaundice, splenomegaly and cerebral irritation. So the transmission of malaria occurs in the form of trophozoite induced malaria or natural malaria. Natural malaria is sporozoite induced, occurs after bite from female Anopheles mosquito. Trophozoite induced malaria is direct erythrocytic schizogony. It is seen in transfusion malaria, malaria in drug addicts and congenital malaria. Lab diagnosis. It is divided into microscopic and non-microscopic. On microscopy, we can prepare a thick and thin peripheral smear or a buffy coat preparation is done and the RBCs are observed for malarial parasite, either the ring forms or the gametocyte form. Also, fluorescent microscopy technique can be done on the qualitative buffy coat. Non-microscopic method is via antigen detection, that is the HR protein or PLDH protein which is present on the malarial parasite. There are and other molecular methods like DNA probes and PCR culture can also be done. Next, moving on to cysticercosis, it is a parasitic disease caused by larval forms of Tinea solium, the Cysticercus cellulose. Tinea solium belongs to cyclophilid cystodes in the family Tinidae. It is caused by ingestion of tapeworms through fecal oral route transmission or autoinfection. It is potentially a dangerous systemic disease with variable clinical manifestations depending on the sites in which the cysticerci are found. The disease is endemic in all Central, South American, Asian and African countries with the exception of Muslim countries where pork is not consumed. The perpetuation of this parasitic disease is related to poor sanitation and hygiene. So the morphology of the Tinea solium worm, it is a flat ribbon-like body which is white in color and measures 2 to 3 meters in length. So it has a scolex, neck and body which is made up of multiple segments known as proglottids. So the scolex. Scolex is quadrate in shape, it has a diameter of 1 millimeter. They have four large cupped suckers, conspicuous rounded rostellum bearing two rows of hooks. These are the hooks. The neck is short, which is about 5 to 10 millimeter in length. Then next, the body has proglottids. There are mature proglottids, immature proglottids and gravid proglottids which contain the eggs. Eggs, these are usually brown, round in color. They are infective to pigs as well as humans. They are bile stained eggs. So pathogenesis, humans are both intermediate and definitive host. Cysticercosis develops when humans become intermediate host. The infective form is the larval stage of the Tinea solium. The mode of transmission is usually fecal-oral route infection, either accidentally ingested from contaminated water or vegetables, or can occur due to humans acquire the infection by ingestion of raw or uncooked meat from animal host. Scolex attaches to the intestine and adults grow in the small intestine. The eggs or gravid proglottids are passed into the environment through the feces. This is then ingested by pigs, where oncospheres hatch, penetrate intestinal wall and circulate into the musculature of humans or pigs. Oncospheres develop into cysticerca in muscles of pigs or in the humans. This, if humans ingest it, then they develop cysticercosis in any organ, it most commonly being subcutaneous tissue as well as in the eyes and brain. Clinical manifestations of cysticercosis depends on the site in which the cysticerca are found. The cysticerca are found in subcutaneous intramuscular tissue followed by the eye and the brain. The incubation period of cysticercosis is variable. Symptoms appear in 15 days to even many years after the initial infection. The types: subcutaneous cysticercosis is usually asymptomatic. Muscular cysticercosis can be asymptomatic, or it can present as a muscle mass or present as acute myositis. It is usually associated with neurocysticercosis. Ocular cysticercosis. Most cysts are found in the vitreous, subretinal space and in conjunctiva. It can present as iritis, uveitis or palpable conjunctivitis. The cysts in subconjunctival or subretinal sites may present as slowly growing nodules confusing with tumors. Occasionally, subretinal cysts may lead to blindness due to detachment of the retina. Neurocysticercosis is the most serious form of cysticercosis. It occurs in 60 to 90% of cysticercosis cases. The clinical manifestations are highly variable. It depends on the number, location and viability of the cyst. The stage of development of the cyst, whether young and mature or intact and degenerated, and also the host's response against the cyst. It is of two types: parenchymal and extraparenchymal. Parenchymal, it is the most common form, caused by infection of the brain parenchyma with cysticerca. Extraparenchymal disease, it is caused by location of cysts in the cerebrospinal fluid of the ventricles, cisterns and subarachnoid space or in the spinal cord. The onset may be insidious or abrupt. Presents with seizures, meningeal cyst and or increased intracranial tension. The diagnosis: the palpable parasitic nodules are often clinically misinterpreted as a benign mesenchymal tumor such as lipoma, neurofibroma or as lymphadenopathy. Various diagnostic modalities employed to detect cysticercosis are radiological, that is CT scan and MRI. It is sensitive in diagnosing cysticercosis, especially when the parasite involves the CNS, but they are very expensive. And next are the serological tests, are useful but cannot rule out the disease with negative test. False positivity is expected with past parasitic infection or cross reactivity with other helminths. So this is the cysticercosis. Next we'll move on to TB, pathogenesis of TB. It is a type 4 hypersensitivity causing granuloma. TB bacilli escape being killed by macrophages because of their mycolic acid wax coat. Also, there is a surface glycolipid which prevents their digestion. So, pathogenesis of tuberculosis. Inhaled Mycobacterium tuberculosis is deposited in the alveoli, usually in the lower segments of lower and middle lobes and anterior segments of the upper lobe. The organisms are phagocytosed by alveolar macrophages, but they resist killing. Cell wall lipids of Mycobacterium tuberculosis block fusion of phagosomes and lysosomes and allow the bacilli to proliferate within the macrophages. As the bacilli multiply, macrophages degrade some and present antigens to the T lymphocytes. Some macrophages carry the organisms from the lung to hilar and mediastinal lymph nodes, from which they may disseminate into the bloodstream to other areas of the body. The bacilli continue to proliferate at the primary site in the lungs and also elsewhere, like lymph nodes, kidneys, meninges, epiphyseal plates of long bone vertebra and the apical areas of the lung. Although the macrophages that first ingest the TB bacilli cannot kill it, they initiate a hypersensitivity cell-mediated immunological response that eventually contains the infection. Infected macrophages present mycobacterial antigens to T cells. A clone of sensitized cells proliferate, producing interferons and activates macrophages, thereby increasing their concentration of lytic enzyme and augmenting their capacity to kill the mycobacteria. The lytic enzymes of these activated macrophages may, if released, also damage host tissue. Development of activated macrophages responsive to Mycobacterium tuberculosis antigen is the hypersensitivity response to the organism. The emergence of activated macrophages that can ingest and destroy the bacilli comprises cell-mediated immune response. These responses work in tandem to combat the proliferative organisms, a process that requires 3 to 6 weeks to come into play. If an infected person is immunologically competent and the burden of organism is small, a vigorous granulomatous reaction is produced. Tuberculous bacilli are ingested and killed by activated macrophages, then surrounded by fibrous tissue and thus successfully contained. When the number of organisms is high, the hypersensitivity reaction produces significant tissue necrosis, which has a characteristic cheese-like consistency, hence called as caseous necrosis. So, this is primary tuberculosis. Mycobacterium enter into the alveoli of the lung. So in 90% of the cases, there is healing, calcification and containment of the disease. Later, the organisms become dormant. So in these cases, there can occur a reinfection or reinactivation of the dormant organism, causing secondary tuberculosis. In 10% of primary tuberculosis cases, they go into progressive primary tuberculosis. This occurs when the bacterial load is high and the human immune response is unable to contain the disease. So this is seen usually in children and immunocompromised host. The primary tuberculosis progresses to biliary tuberculosis, that is multiple sites are involved, like the meninges, the vertebrae, lymph nodes, lungs, liver, spleen, adrenals, joints and bones. The lung lesion of primary tuberculosis is known as the Gons focus. It is found in the subpleural area of the upper segments of the lower lobes or in the lower segments of the upper lobes. Initially, it is a small, well-defined area of inflammatory consolidation which drains into the hilar lymph nodes. The combination of a peripheral Gons focus and involved mediastinal or hilar lymph nodes is called as a Gons complex. So the Gons complex is composed of tuberculous granuloma. They have a rounded outline, central caseous necrosis, transformed macrophages called as epithelioid cells, lymphocytes, plasma cells and fibroblasts, also classically seen as Langhans giant cells. So this is a granuloma which has a well-rounded outline, central caseating necrosis. This is a Langhans giant cell. These are the epithelioid macrophages and periphery of lymphocytes and activated fibroblasts. Primary tuberculosis, it is usually a self-limited disease. Can form Gons complex or primary complex. Primary progressive TB occurs in 10% of immunocompromised individuals. Common in malnourished children, it causes miliary TB and meningitis. Secondary tuberculosis, it occurs in post-primary tuberculosis in immunized individuals. It occurs due to reactivation or reinfection. Apical lobes or upper part of the lower lobes are involved. It can cause caseating or cavitatory lesion called as the soft granuloma. It can occur in pulmonary or in extrapulmonary sites. It can be local or systemic, that is miliary disease. So this is primary or Gons complex. Primary tuberculosis is the pattern seen with initial infection TB in children. This is the primary Gons focus. This is the Gons complex. So, cavitatory tube. This is a cross specimen of cavitatory tuberculosis. When the soft necrotic center drain out, leaving behind a cavity. Cavitation is typical for large granuloma. So this is a cavity. It is more common in reactivated tuberculosis seen in the upper lobes. So these are multiple granuloma seen in the lung. This shows central caseous necrosis. This is a Langhans giant cell. So this is a cavitatory tuberculosis. This is a cavity seen in the lung. So next we have leprosy. Leprosy is a chronic infectious disease caused by Mycobacterium leprae. It is also known as Hansen's disease. It affects mainly the cooler parts of the body like skin, mouth, respiratory tract, peripheral nerves, eyes, superficial lymph node and testis. It is estimated 12 to 15 million cases are worldwide. Most prevalent in tropical countries like India, Central Africa, Southeast Asia, Central and South America. It is caused by Mycobacterium leprae. Mycobacterium leprae is an obligate intracellular gram-positive organism. It is also acid-fast, whereas it is less acid-fast compared to Mycobacterium tuberculosis. It cannot be grown in vitro. It can be grown in the foot pads of mice, that is nine-banded and also nine-banded armadillo. So how do we demonstrate Mycobacterium leprae? So these can be demonstrated in tissue sections, split skin smears, scrapings from the edges of infections and also nasal smears. It can be stained using acid fast staining. The staining is similar to that of Mycobacterium tuberculosis but can be decolorized by lower concentration, that is 5% sulfuric acid. That is, it is less acid fast than compared to Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Another method of staining is phytopharyngostaining. It is a modified ZN staining procedure. It is a better method to demonstrate Mycobacterium leprae. Another stain which can be used is gomorimethamine silver. So, mode of transmission of Mycobacterium leprae is by droplet infection. That is, from upper respiratory tract infection, it can spread. It is the most common route. Or also by direct contact. Untreated leprosy patients can shed numerous bacilli from their damaged skin. Maternal fetal transmission is very rare and can occur via the placenta. Transmission from milk of leprosy patient to the infant can also occur. So classification of leprosy. Broadly, leprosy is classified depending on the clinical characteristic, histopathological changes and also immunological stage of the individual. So it is classified into tuberculoid leprosy, wherein there is high resistance to the lepra bacilli, and lepromatous leprosy, where there is low resistance. These are called as the polar forms of leprosy. Cases not fitting into either of these two classification are termed as borderline or intermediate types. So the classification of leprosy is based on modified Ridley-Joplin's classification. So the polar forms are tuberculoid leprosy and lepromatous leprosy. The indeterminate or borderline forms are borderline tuberculoid, tuberculoid indefinite, mid-borderline, lepromatous indefinite and borderline lepromatous leprosy. Tuberculoid leprosy, it is a stable form of leprosy. It's common in India and Africa, but clinically it presents with multiple sharply defined reddish brown anesthetic plaques or patches. It is asymmetrically distributed throughout the body. There is usually a thickened nerve is involved. Histopathologically, the dermis shows granulomas resembling hard tubercles composed of epithelioid cells, Langhans giant cells and peripheral mantle of lymphocytes. Lesions have a predilection for dermal nerves which may be destroyed or infiltrated by epithelioid cells and lymphocytes. Granulomatous infiltrate erodes the basal layer of the epidermis. Lepra bacilli are fewer in number in these lesions. So multiple granulomas which are eroding the basal layer of the dermis is seen. Again, this is a granuloma which is abutting to the basal layer of epidermis. It's a Langhans giant cell is seen. These are the epithelioid cells, Langhans giant cells. In lepromatous leprosy, it usually develops from borderline lepromatous leprosy by a downgrading reaction. Multiple symmetric hypopigmented erythematous maculopapillar or nodular lesions are seen in the skin. On histopathological examination, in dermis, there is a proliferation of macrophages which are foamy, particularly around the blood vessels, nerves and dermal appendages. These are called as the lepra cells or Virchow cells. Lepra cells are heavily laden with acid fast bacilli and may be seen as compact globular masses called a globi, or they are arranged in a parallel fashion called as cigarettes in a pack. So there is a clear zone of demarcation between the dermal infiltrate and the epidermis, and also the epidermis is thinned out or ulcerated. So this is lepromatous leprosy morphology. There is a zone of clearing between the inflammatory infiltrate and the epidermis. There is a zone of uninvolved area. So these are the foamy macrophages which are laden by lepra bacilli. Again, foamy macrophages. So these are the foamy macrophages stained with acid fast bacilli. All these pink rod like structures are the lepra bacilli. So this is a table to differentiate between lepromatous and tuberculoid leprosy. The skin lesions are symmetrical, they are asymmetrical, they are multiple hypopigmented, they are single or fewer lesion, hypopigmented and erythematous. Nerve involvement present, but there is no sensory disturbance. In tuberculoid leprosy, nerve involvement is present with distinct sensory disturbance. Histopathologically, there is collection of foamy macrophages with lepra cells in the dermis separated from epidermis by a clear zone. There is a hard, in tuberculoid leprosy, there is a hard tubercle similar to granulomatous lesion eroding the basal layer of epidermis. There is no clear zone. Bacteriologically, lepra cells are highly positive for lepra bacilli, whereas in tuberculoid leprosy, lepra bacilli are few and they are usually seen in destroyed nerves. Immunity is low, whereas tuberculoid leprosy, there is a good immune response. Lepromin test is negative in lepromatous leprosy and positive in tuberculoid leprosy. Next infection, syphilis. Syphilis is a chronic sexually transmitted systemic infection caused by Treponema pallidum. It is a thin, long spirochete that cannot be grown in artificial media. The disease was first recognized in Europe in the 1490s and has been related to Columbus's return from the New World. Urbanization and mass movement of people caused by war contributed to its rapid spread. Originally, syphilis was an acute disease that caused destructive skin lesions and early death, but it has become milder and a more protracted and has an insidious clinical course. Epidemiology. Syphilis is a worldwide disease that is transmitted by sexual contact. Infection is also spread from an infected mother to her fetus, that is, it causes congenital syphilis. The incidence of primary and secondary syphilis has declined since the introduction of penicillin. Treponema pallidum is a very fragile and is easily killed by soap, antiseptics, drying or in cold temperatures. Person-to-person transmission requires direct contact between a rich source of spirochete, that is an open lesion, and mucous membrane or abraded skin of the genital organs, rectum, mouth, fingers or nipples. The organisms reproduce at the site of inoculation, pass through regional lymph nodes, gain access into the systemic circulation and then disseminate throughout the body. Although Treponema pallidum induces an inflammatory response and is taken up by phagocytic cells, it persists and proliferates. Chronic infection and inflammation cause tissue destruction, sometimes occurring for decades. The course of syphilis is divided into three stages, that is primary syphilis, secondary syphilis and tertiary syphilis. Primary syphilis features a chancre. The classic lesion of primary syphilis is the chancre. It is an ulcer at the site of occurring at the site of Treponema pallidum entry, usually the penis, vulva, anus or mouth. It appears 1 week to 3 months after exposure with an average incubation period of 3 weeks. It tends to be solitary and has a firm raised border. Spirochetes tend to concentrate in vessel walls and in the epidermis around the ulcer. Chancres as well as the lesions of other stages of syphilis display a characteristic vasculitis in which endothelial cells proliferate and swell and vessel walls become thickened and lymphocytes and fibrous tissue. The chancre quickly erodes to a characteristic ulcer. The chancres are painless and can go unnoticed in some locations such as the uterine cervix and canal and mouth. They last 3 to 12 weeks, are frequently accompanied by inguinal lymph node and healing without scarring. In secondary syphilis, there is dissemination of the spirochetes. The Treponema pallidum spreads systemically and proliferates to cause lesions in the skin, mucous membranes, lymph nodes, meninges, stomach and liver. Lesions show perivascular lymphocytic infiltrate and endarteritis obliterans. In the skin, most common presentation of secondary syphilis is an erythematous and maculopapular rash involving the trunk and extremities and often includes the palms and soles. The rash appears 2 weeks to 3 months after the chancre heals. Variety of other skin lesions in secondary syphilis include condyloma lata, that is exudative plaques in the perineum, vulva or scrotum which abound in spirochetes. Follicular syphilis, small papillary lesions around hair follicles that cause loss of hair, and numeral syphilis, coin-like lesions involving the face and perineum. In the mucous membranes, lesions on mucosal surface of the mouth and genital organs called mucus patches teem with organisms and are highly infectious. Lymph nodes, characteristic changes in lymph nodes, especially epitrochlear lymph nodes, include a thickened capsule, follicular hyperplasia, increased number of plasma cells and macrophages, and lytic vasculitis. Numerous spirochetes are present in the lymph nodes of secondary syphilis. In the meninges, although the meninges are commonly seeded with treponema pallidum, this involvement is frequently asymptomatic. Tertiary syphilis causes neurologic and vascular disease. After lesions of secondary syphilis have subsided, an asymptomatic period lasts for years or decades. However, spirochetes continue to multiply and the deep-seated lesions of tertiary syphilis gradually develop in 1/3 of untreated patients. There is focal ischemic necrosis secondary to obliterative endarteritis, and is the underlying mechanism for many of the processes associated with tertiary syphilis. Treponema pallidum induces a mononuclear inflammatory infiltrate predominantly composed of lymphocytes and plasma cells. These cells infiltrate small arteries and arterioles, producing a characteristic obstructive vascular lesion that is called as endarteritis obliterans. The small arteries are inflamed and their endothelial cells are swollen. They are surrounded by concentric layers of proliferating fibroblasts which confer an appearance to these vascular lesions. So there is primary syphilis, which is characterized by chancre in the male or female genitalia. Next, there is systemic dissemination leading to secondary syphilis, where there is skin involvement, lymphadenopathy and rash in the palms and soles. After a later period of 1 to 30 years, there is development of tertiary syphilis causing paralytic dementia, aortic aneurysm, aortic insufficiency, tapes dorsalis and gummas. So these are the chancres involving the genitals and the palms, genitals chancres. Neurosyphilis. The slowly progressive infection damages the meninges, cerebral cortex, spinal cord, cranial nerves or eyes. Tertiary syphilis involving the CNS is subclassified according to the predominant tissue infected. Thus, there are meningovascular syphilis, tapes dorsalis when it involves the spinal cord, and general paresis when it involves the cerebral cortex. Moving on to leishmaniasis. Leishmaniasis is a chronic inflammatory disease of the skin, mucous membranes or viscera caused by obligate intracellular protozoan parasites transmitted through the bite of infected sandflies. Leishmanial infection is exacerbated by conditions that interfere with T cell function, such as AIDS. Culture or histological examination is used to diagnose the infection. The life cycle of leishmania involves two forms: the promastigote form, which develops and lives extracellularly in the sandfly vector, and the amastigote form, which multiplies intracellular in the host macrophages. Promastigotes produce two abundant surface glycoproteins. The first, lipophosphoglycan, forms a dense glycocalyx that both activates complement and inhibits complement action. The second surface glycoprotein, GP63, is zinc-dependent proteinase that cleaves complement and some lysosomal antimicrobial enzymes. GP63 also binds to fibronectin receptors on macrophages and promotes promastigote adhesion to macrophages. Morphologically, visceral leishmania caused by Leishmania donovani or Leishmania chagasi parasites invade macrophages throughout the mononuclear phagocyte system and cause severe systemic disease marked by hepatosplenomegaly, lymphadenopathy, pancytopenia, fever and weight loss. Can also cause Kalazar or black fever. Cutaneous leishmaniasis caused by Leishmania major mexicana and Leishmania brasiliensis is a relatively mild form localized disease consisting of ulcer on exposed skin. Mucocutaneous leishmaniasis caused by Leishmania brasiliensis causes ulcerating or non-ulcerating lesions which may be disfiguring, develop in the nasopharyngeal areas. Diffuse cutaneous leishmaniasis is a rare form of dermal infection, begins as a single skin node which continues spreading until the entire body is covered by nodular lesions. Microscopically, they contain aggregates of foamy macrophages stuffed with leishmania. So this is a macrophage stuffed with Leishmania Donovan bodies. Amoebiasis, it's caused by Entamoeba hemolytica. It is associated with poor education, poverty, overcrowding, HIV infection and unsanitary conditions. Mode of spread is usually fecal spread. So the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica, it has an infective stage, that is a cyst stage. It is quadrinucleated, ingested by contact with fecally contaminated food, passes through stomach and exits in lower small bubble. Metacystic amoeba with 4 cystic nuclei from each cyst, 8 small trophocytes from each metacystic amoeba. Trophocytes are carried to the cecum. The trophozoite stage, they are uninucleate. They show erythrophagocytosis, reside, feed and multiply by binary fission in the lumen of the colon. May invade and metastasize to the liver and other extraintestinal sites. Trophocytes adhere to the colonic mucosal glycoproteins via galactose and N-acetyl D-galactosamine specific lectin. Adherence results in cell lysis and PMN invasion. Polymorphonuclear neutrophils are then lysed, releasing lytic enzymes causing more tissue destruction. Small foci of necrosis in the intestinal wall coalesce to form ulcers. These ulcers are flash-shaped. So this is a flash-shaped ulcer in the intestine. Next, hydatid disease, caused by Echinococcus granulosis. Humans are a definitive and intermediate host. Definitive hosts are dogs and sheep are usually intermediate hosts. Humans are accidental intermediate hosts infected by ingestion of food contaminated with eggs shed by dogs or foxes. Eggs hatch in the duodenum and invade the liver, lungs or bones. About 2/3 of human Echinococcus granulosis cysts are found in the liver, 5-15% in the lung, and the rest are present in bones, brain and other organs. Larvae lodge within the capillaries and first incite an inflammatory reaction composed principally of mononuclear leukocytes and eosinophils. Many such larvae are destroyed but others exist. The cysts begin to at microscopic levels and progressively increase in size. Inner nucleated germinative layer and an outer opaque non-nucleated layer. Outside this opaque layer, there is usually a host inflammatory reaction that produces a zone of fibroblasts, giant cells and mononuclear eosinophilic cells. In time, a defensive dense fibrous capsule forms. Daughter cysts often develop within the large mother cyst. These appear first as minute projections of the germinative layer that develop central vesicles and thus form tiny brood capsules. Genetic coalesces of the worm produce a fine sand-like sediment within the cyst. Next, lymphatic filariasis. It is transmitted by mosquitoes and is caused by Wuchereria bancrofti or Brugia malayi species. Filariasis causes a spectrum of disease. It can cause asymptomatic microfilariemia, recurrent lymphadenitis, chronic lymphadenitis with swelling of the dependent lymphoscrotum and tropical pulmonary eosinophilia. The pathogenesis, infective larvae released by mosquitoes into the tissues during a blood meal develop within lymphatic channels into adult males and females which mate and release microfilaria that enter into the bloodstream. Brugia malayi produces several surface glycoproteins with antioxidant function which may protect from superoxide and free oxygen radicals. Homologous of cystatin, cysteine protease inhibitors which can impair the MHC class II antigen processing pathway. Serpin, serine protease inhibitors which can inhibit neutrophil proteases and critical inflammatory mediators. Homologous of TGF-beta which can bind to mammalian TGF-beta receptors and may downregulate inflammatory responses. Morphologically, chronic filariasis is characterized by persistent lymphedema of the extremities, scrotum, penis or vulva. In severe and long-lasting infections, chylous weeping of the enlarged scrotum may ensue or a chronically swollen leg may develop tough subcutaneous fibrosis and epithelial hyperkeratosis termed as elephantiasis. Adult filarial worms, live, dead or calcified, are present in the draining lymphatics or nodes surrounded by mild or no inflammation. An intense eosinophilia with hemorrhage and fibrin are seen in recurrent filarial funiculoepididymitis. It can also present with granulomas. So this is a peripheral limb showing elephantiasis. So that's the end of the class. Give your attendance. Thank you.